Thank you very much, Mr. President, ladies and gentlemen. In this room, maybe an hour ago, I sat there and I was objectified. I was treated like a piece of meat by Harry, and you all sat there and laughed. And let me tell you something. The Irish Constitution did nothing to stop it. Now, we could decide, therefore, to burn it down, or we could say no constitution, no matter how good, can stop someone like Harry. He's just a force of nature. He's going to do whatever he's going to do. And we could judge this constitution on a rational basis of what it did, of what it could do, and what it can do. And that's what I'm going to suggest to you this evening. Ladies and gentlemen, you might think that because I am a constitutional scholar, that therefore I would have a real interest in preserving the Irish Constitution, that I'm professionally compromised and biased in this. That could be true in one way. I've written a very large book on the Constitution. It really is very big. About 3,000 pages, only €325. Go out and buy a copy afterwards. And you would think I wouldn't want to rewrite all of that in the event that the proposition wins, and you'd be right. At the same time, if I have to do that, we get to sell more books, and that's more money for me. So frankly, either way, I'm golden, and therefore am in fact entirely neutral in the context of this debate. And so to try and defend this constitution, I want to talk about a couple of things. I want to talk about, first of all, the idea that if you understand the context and history of the Irish Constitution, it's a document that, in fact, we should be incredibly proud of. It's a history we should embrace, that we should be slow to cast off. And if we really understood that history, it's something that I think the Irish state could really stand behind, not only now, but for many decades to come. And the reason for that is the context of the Irish Constitution is 1930s Europe. You might know something about the history of Europe in the late 1930s. Things weren't going that well. Shall we say, democracy, something of a downward trajectory at that time. Various regimes that didn't look at the time to be terribly savoury turned out to be much worse. And in this context, we have Eamon de Valera and his party in power deciding to write a new Irish constitution. And what they do is remarkable, and it's remarkable for the following reason. At that time, they were as functionally unconstrained as any government in Europe. We've heard before from other speakers that the preceding constitution that we had, the constitution of 1922, was basically in tatters. The Senate had been abolished because De Valera didn't like it. There was no governor general anymore, this important institution that had to approve all of the laws of the state. All of the constitutional rights that we had been torn up and tossed out. And this is the situation that Eamon de Valera faced. Functionally a dictator, a strong parliamentary majority, overwhelming popular support, and completely unfettered power that would match any dictator that would follow in Europe in the next two decades. And in that moment, a moment where you could do anything, reshape the state in your image and rule it like a king, what do you decide to do? You decide to give your power away. You decide to write a new constitution, with a separation of powers and judicial review, or courts and stuff, as we've had it referred to earlier in the debate. You have courts and stuff, ladies and gentlemen, restraining the power of a government that could have ruled without any limits. The opposition to Eamon de Valera was in fact calling for him not to do this, because they were imagining being in power at some point. And why would you want to rule within limits when you can rule in any way you want? They encouraged him not to have a strong constitution and a strong independent judiciary to oversee it. They encouraged him to allow constitutional flexibility and allow governance in any which way. Instead, De Valera and the people who voted for the Irish Constitution chose to bind themselves, chose to say they would limit their own power, and they would commit themselves to a democratic order that would have accountability of government, judicial oversight, strong protection of rights. Those are things that were not in the ascendancy at the time. Those are things that persist with us to this day, and whatever their flaws, have provided for the foundations of a state that on the whole has served us reasonably well. And looking at that history in that context, to turn our back on that and to carelessly toss out this document as if we could replace it by something that, let's say, Jack came up with on the back of a napkin is frankly disrespectful to that history, ladies and gentlemen, and ignores how important that was, how rare and how unusual. But secondly, let's talk about the flaws. Let's talk about some of the problems we've heard about, because they aren't always as bad as they seem. We've heard that the Constitution is highly religious, that it's this highly sectarian document. And I will concede, first of all, the Constitution has religious rhetoric that seems out of place. We wouldn't put it in today. Powers coming under God, our divine Lord Jesus Christ, supporting our fathers through centuries of trial. These are not things we put in today. It also had blasphemy, it had divorce, and other things we have since removed, a special position of the Catholic Church, although it was pretty meaningless, that were there at the time and were highly religious in nature. But it also fundamentally separated church and state. It protected you from religious discrimination. It protected your religious freedom, whatever your faith, and was in fact entirely neutral as between religions in terms of the application of the law. That's not to say the Irish state didn't have a colossal problem in terms of religion throughout the 20th century and the intermingling of church and state. It's to say that's not the Constitution's fault, it was ours. It is a fault not in our stars, but in ourselves. You are dealing with a people who were overwhelmingly Catholic, not only in terms of overwhelming numbers of people who were Catholic, but whose Catholicism was overwhelming of everything else. Our Constitution had to be sent to the Vatican to be essentially approved by the Pope. And if it wasn't, the government was entirely convinced the referendum to pass it would fail. So sure was it that the Irish people would disapprove if the Pope disapproved. They wrote the most secular constitution they could. They tried to protect the rights of every religion, majority and minority. And in the end, the problem with the intermingling of church and state in the 20th century is the intermingling of people and the church. That we and our antecedents wanted to be governed by religious norms. We wanted to impose religious norms on our fellow men and women in this country. That was our choice. And the fact that the Constitution didn't stop us is, first of all, not the Constitution's fault, it's ours. And second of all, is completely unrealistic to expect. We can't expect a document written in 1930s Europe by these people would have done that. We can only expect that we can do it today, and we can. The Constitution also protected various fundamental rights that you continue to enjoy. It enshrined a separation of powers that gives you government accountability, that gives you free and fair elections, that gives you genuinely representative democracy, whatever its many, many faults. Again, think about the people we elect rather than the system of election the Constitution provides for when you're assigning blame for that. It does all of that and has done it in a way that has served this state through more than 80 years of functional governance, of no major constitutional crises, and surviving lots of periods where other parts of Europe were in constitutional turmoil, even up to today, cough, Britain, Brexit, etc. Our Constitution has managed to steer us well through so many trials. And the only reason you should change it, and I'm not saying you never should burn the Constitution, maybe you should in certain circumstances, is if there is no way it can continue to serve us. Why might that be? Well, perhaps at some point we might discuss unity of this island and the possibility of a border poll north and south of the border. And in that context, we might want to write a completely new constitution for a completely new phase of history. It might be that the values enshrined in certain parts of the constitution are so repellent to you that you want to throw it out and throw it away from you. But I say you shouldn't. You should embrace the good parts of its history. You should be proud of the things that it did well. And you should accept its faults as things we can change, but not things we have to renege from entirely. And that brings me on to my final point, which is this. Utopian thinking is really not helpful. We exist in a fallen state. We are not some sort of perfect or perfectible beings. We are a race of people that argue and bicker, that perhaps difference and argument and disagreement is the hallmark and nature of our condition. And in fact, if constitutionalism is about anything, it's about human frailty. Madison said in the context of the US Constitution that if people were angels, there would be no need for government. We have government, we have accountability, we have rights for the precise reason that we are imperfect. And so if we seek perfection in a constitutional document, we miss the point. They're not supposed to be perfect. They're supposed to allow for our imperfections and supposed to enable us to try and avoid the worst mistakes we can make and to fix the mistakes that we do make. And judged by that standard, this constitution is successful, because Owen and others have told you, we've changed this document. Most of the things people have complained about have been altered by referendum. Some of the ones that haven't, like the women's place in the home, is due for a change, and in fact we would have changed it last November if we hadn't decided to have a citizens' assembly about carers for reasons. Essentially, when we look at the problems that have been pointed out, these are problems in us, and this is very much echoing Kate's point beginning our case on the opposition. The faults of the Constitution are ours, those of ourselves and our antecedents that wrote the Constitution before us. Those are our faults, but our virtues are its virtues too. And if you see flaws in yourself, you don't immolate yourself on the spot, ladies and gentlemen. Instead, you think about the fact that you have some virtues too. You understand that your past and your history and your context is responsible for some of those flaws, and understand and hope that maybe in time you can let the better nature, the better angels of your nature win out. And as with ourselves, ladies and gentlemen, as we would treat ourselves and our own flaws and our own imperfections and try and judge ourselves well and fairly on what we do well, I commend the House, the Irish Constitution. Thank you.